where do I go? When there's no one else to turn to, who do I talk to? When no one wants to listen, who do I lean on? Oh, oh. When there's no foundation stable, I go to the rock. I know he is able, I can go to the rock. I can go to the rock of my salvation. I go to the stone that the builders rejected. I run to the mountain, and the mountain stands by me. When all around me is sinking sand, on Christ the solid rock I stand. When I need a shelter, when I need a friend, I can go to the rock. Where do I go? When there's no one else to turn to, who do I talk to? When no one wants to listen, who do I lean on? Oh, oh. When there's no foundation stable, I go to the rock. I know he is able, I can go to the rock.
Making it loud. Let's raise the game. We're not afraid. He's with us every breath, he's with us every step, so we can leave fear in the dust behind us. If you wanna raise the game, he will give you strength to reach another level in Jesus' name. If you wanna raise the game, he will give you strength to reach another level in Jesus' name. We are moving up, moving up. We are making it loud. We're making it loud. Making it loud, we're not afraid. We are moving up, moving up. We are making it loud. We're making it loud. Let's raise the game.
Hello, my friends. I want you to raise your hands if you're happy to be at church today. Me too. I love worshiping with you. Now tell me, who made those hands that you just raised? That's right. God made them. And boy, did he do an incredible job. I love the way that God made me and each and every one of you. You are all so special and so beautiful and so unique. Unique means that there's no one else in the whole wide world just like you. You are a one and only. You stand alone in your awesomeness. No one else looks exactly like you or has the same calling or purpose as you do. Let's go over our memory verse for the month of August. So get ready to hear it and get ready to memorize it. I want you to know this truth deep in your hearts and so that you will always remember how special, amazing, and treasured you are. Our memory verse says this: I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Psalm 139:14. Say the verse with me again and say it like you mean it. I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Psalm 139:14. That's right. You're so special because you're made by God. He loves you and he made you in a special way. Who made you? I want everyone to touch your head like this. Put your hand on your head. What do you feel? Hair? Yes, God made people with hair. Some have lots of hair, some have a little hair, some people have no hair at all. But no matter if you have a little bit or a lot, God knows exactly how many hairs on your head. It's true. The Bible teaches us that God knows every hair on our head, every single one. Look at the friend sitting beside you. Can you imagine trying to count the exact numbers of hairs on their heads? That would be so hard. It'd be impossible. But God knows. God knows how many hairs are on your head, and he knows about every person's head. He knows how many hairs are in Tim's beard right now as he's filming me. He even knows how many hairs are white. Ugh. God even knows when one hair falls into your shirt, or when you get your hair cut, or when you brush your hair and they get stuck in your hairbrush. God knows. And you know what all of the hair stuff means? It means you're very important to God. That's what it means. You are so important to God that he even knows how many hairs are on your head. You are important to God when you're happy or sad or mad or silly. You're important to God when you do something right and when you do something wrong. When you're at the dentist or you're running around in the playground or when you're asleep in your bed or cleaning up your toys, which I hope you do every day, you are important to God whether you're at the back of the line or the front of the line. God made you, and that makes you very, very important to him. Now, do you remember what you're supposed to say when I ask this, who made you? Well, I want you to hear it, say it, and I want to hear it very loud. Who made you? God made you. God made me and He made you, and that makes you very important to God. Okay, friends, it's time to pray. So will you close your eyes with me and talk to God with me? Dear Jesus, I thank you for every little heart that's listening this morning. I thank you that you made us. You love us so much that you see even the hairs on our heads and you count them and you know the number. Thank you, Jesus, that you love us, that you have a plan for us and a purpose for us, and that you made us special and unique. May we bring you glory in everything that we do and say today. And we pray this in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you, preschoolers. I hope you know how special you are, how amazing you are, and how much God wants to be your best friend forever. I love you, and I can't wait to see you again. I'll see you next week. Hello, my creative friends. Yes, I called you creative because that's what you are. Usually we think of creativity as painting or writing or singing, and that's true. We can definitely be creative through art, but there's so much more to creativity than just painting or music. Creativity is imagining what you could do because you're made in God's image. You see, God's creativity is indescribable. It's limitless. It goes beyond what we could ever imagine. So if we're made in God's image, we are creative. God was imaginative and creative when He designed us uniquely, which means no one else in the whole wide world is the same as us. No one, not one person. We stand alone in our awesomeness. Now this morning, I want you to crack open your Bible to the New Testament, which is in the last part of your Bible. Now Genesis is the beginning of the Bible. The New Testament starts with the Gospel of Matthew in the back of the Bible. There are many books in that part of the Bible, almost like unique chapters that are found in a novel that you might be reading. Each one is different and unique. Now in the New Testament, we can find quite a few letters written by a man named Paul. Paul wrote to believers in different churches. He wanted to encourage them as they tried to follow Jesus. Now, side note about Paul, he hadn't always been a Jesus follower himself. But once he did decide to put his faith in Jesus, he made it his life's work to encourage others to believe too. In fact, he traveled all over to teach people and share with them what it meant to follow Jesus. Now, Paul started a church in Ephesus. The churches back then, they didn't really look like our church now. The believers usually just met in their homes. The fact that you're watching me right now in your home, surrounded by family and maybe even a few friends, is how church was back in Bible times. Now, after Paul started the church in Ephesus, now Ephesus is a city, much like Spokane's a city where you live, the believers in Ephesus were from different backgrounds, but one thing they had in common was that they believed in Jesus and that He had died and come back to life. Now, as Paul went around telling people about Jesus, he was so bold that he actually got in trouble with the Roman government. Now, they didn't want people talking about Jesus. So Paul ended up in jail in Rome. But even though Paul had good reason to complain, he used his time creatively. He wrote letters to the churches that he had started, including the church in Ephesus. He reminded them that God created us to do good things for others. Now check out what he wrote as it's recorded in Ephesians 2:10. We are God's creation. He created us to belong to Christ Jesus. Now we can do good works. Long ago, God created these good works for us to do. Now that's really good stuff, so let's break it down a little bit. The first part of that verse says this, we are God's creation. Now all throughout the Bible, we read that God not only created us, but He made us in His image. That means that God made us to be like Him. And since God's creative, we can be creative too. Now let's get back to that verse, Ephesians 2:10. We are God's creation. He created us to belong to Christ Jesus. That means when we put our trust in Jesus, it changes the way we see the world. It means that we are His and we belong to Him, and He takes care of us and loves us because we belong to Him. Now let's finish reading what Paul wrote in Ephesians 2:10. We are God's creation. He created us to belong to Christ Jesus. Now we can do good works. Long ago, God prepared those works for us to do. Now we can do good works, and that means we can use our creativity to do the good works that God planned for us to do. We can use the gifts God gave us to help the people around the world. God created each one of us, and He's planned out good works for us to do, good works that encourage others and show them God's love. Now here's something that we need to remember. The creativity God has given us isn't just about art and music. God has designed you in a unique way to love Him and love others. That's right. Paul meant by good works, he meant that we can use these unique ways that God's designed us to show love to other people. For some people, those creative good works are things like drawing and songwriting or painting, incredible works of art. For someone else, creativity might look totally different, like building a robot, designing cool apps and games or making people laugh, or inventing 127 new uses for pool noodles. No matter how God made you creative, you can use that creativity to help others. But before you can use your creativity, you need to believe that you're creative in the first place. And I'm here to tell you that it's true. Our bottom line for this Sunday, God created you so you can be creative. Maybe you're thinking, okay, that all sounds great, but I have no clue how to be creative. Well, think about the things you like to do, the things you're naturally good at. Ask a parent or your sibling or a friend what they see in you. Ask God to show you new ways to use your creativity to help people around you. God not only made you to be creative, but He wants you to help use that creativity. You can trust God no matter what, and you can always ask Him for help. There are just so many forms of creativity as there are human beings, so don't judge your own creativity by what others do. Some of you might be great at visual arts, while others of you are great at solving problems. I bet someone in here is a creative communicator. You're good at helping others understand things. And someone else is probably good at planning your birthday party or maybe directing plays with your brothers and sisters. The possibilities are endless. When I was a kid, I collected a bunch of sticks and I turned them into neat designs in my backyard, and then I charged kids a quarter to come look at my stick museum. Now that's creative and lucrative. I want each of you to pray about the gifts and creativity and the calling that God has given you and ask Him to show you how you can use it to make an impact on the world around you. In fact, why don't you join with me right now and we'll pray that over you. Heavenly Father, thank you for your creativity and imagination as you created each one of us, as you formed us, as you planned us, as you fashioned us and made us exactly how we are. Thank you for that, Jesus. Thank you that you loved us so much that you gave us life. You gave us breath in our lungs and a heart that beats and a mind that thinks. And I pray for every young person that you will stir up their creativity to know you, to share your love with those around them, and God, just to be encouraged by the creativity you've given them. We love you, Jesus, and we are so thankful for everything that you are doing, the things that we don't see and the things that we do see. And we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. I love that you are all creative in your unique way. I can't wait to see you and hug you and talk to you, and it should be happening soon. I love you guys. Have a great Sunday.